हेलो हेलो
यस मैम, यस मैम,
श्रद्धा मैडम, वी कैन स्टार्ट नाउ।
ओके मैम, या अ वेरी गुड मॉर्निंग एंड अ वेरी वार्म वेलकम टू डे थ्री ऑफ AICTE स्पॉन्सर्ड 2 वीक ऑनलाइन प्रोग्राम ऑन आर्टिफिशियल इंटेलिजेंस एंड इट्स एप्लीकेशंस इन I am Shraddha Bhingardive on behalf of JSPM's Rajarshi Shahu College of Engineering, Department of Electronics and Telecommunication. Take it as my privilege to welcome our today's speaker, Dr. Yogita Chitriv ma'am, currently working as Assistant Professor in Department of Electronics and Telecommunication. Ma'am has a PhD from RTM Nagpur University, M.Tech in Electronics from RTM Nagpur University. She has 15 years of teaching experience in Yashwantrao Chavan College of Engineering, Nagpur. She has delivered number of expert lectures in FDPs, STTPs, workshop for faculties. Ma'am has received research funding from BST of about 7.91 lakhs, from Harvard University, USA, $40,000, and AICTE RPS, 4.67 lakhs. She has filed 2 patents. Ma'am is also winner of Women Bhaskar Award in the category of education by the hands of Mrs. Amrita Fadavnis and Nagpur Mayor. Ma'am has received scholarship of 1,000 euro from Medical Imaging using Bio-Inspired and Soft Computing, International Conference on Medical Imaging using Bio-Inspired and Soft Computing, organized at Belgium. She has received travel grant for paper presentation in IEEE HTC 2018 in Colombo, Sri Lanka. Ma'am has presented papers in reputed conferences at IIT Bombay, IIT Dhanbad, IISc Bangalore, ISC, ISI Calcutta, Singapore, Belgium, and Sri Lanka. She has 16 research publications in Scopus with citation of 102, H index 4. She has 9 research publications in Web of Science with citation of 44 and H index 2, holding 4 copyrights by Copyright Office, Government of India. Ma'am is also an active member of various institutes like IEEE, ISTE, IAENG, and IACSIT. Ma'am, on behalf of JSPM's Rajarshi Shahu College of Engineering, I welcome you, ma'am.
Thank you, Shraddha, ma'am.
Request to proceed with the session, ma'am.
Yes. So let me share the screen. So is this screen is visible?
Yes, ma'am.
So good morning all. So I'm thankful to the college for inviting me for this FDP, for delivering this lecture on this topic. So the outline of my presentation would be, we'll be covering a brief on AI, ML and DL, that is artificial intelligence, machine learning, and deep learning. As we know, these are the buzzwords which we are really listening nowadays a lot. Then the building blocks of convolutional neural network, which is widely used for image processing. Then how deep learnings are useful in medical image processing. What are the challenges? What are the open research which is available for us? And then what is the future scope in medical image processing in biomedical applications. Then after developing the algorithm on which basis we can assess our algorithms, or we can assess our whatever we have developed. So that evaluation parameters we'll go on discussing. And then one case study of brain MR image analysis I will be discussing with you. So this is in short the outline. So as we know, these are the three buzzwords we are really listening nowadays a lot: artificial intelligence, machine learning, and deep learning. So they are sometimes used in synonyms, but there is a difference, and their era is also varies. means artificial intelligence was started in the year of 1950s, and then it goes up to 1980s. Then the machine learning algorithms comes in 1980s. It lasts up to 2010, and now we are only listening about the deep learning. So basically, artificial intelligence is what is the any technique which enables computer to mimic human behavior. And machine learning is a subset of AI techniques which uses some statistical methods. It uses some set of rules to improve the experience, to improve the accuracy through the experiences. So if we'll find the difference, so artificial intelligence is a broader concept of machine which is able to do the task which we can say as a smart task or intelligent task. And machine learning is a current application of AI in which what we do, we give access of data to the machines so that it will learn by themselves. So we know nowadays whenever we download any application, so it asks us the access. So we give access of gallery, we give access of video and everything. So through that experiences, it learns and it improve itself. And then we are having deep learning, which is a subset of machine learning, which makes the computation of multilayer neural network feasible. So this is in short, we can say deep learning is a subset of machine learning. Machine learning is a subset of artificial intelligence. And now in 2010 onward, we are having deep learning everywhere. And that too for medical image application, it is playing a vital role. So artificial intelligence, we will be having input and then there will be some intelligence and the output will be like this. So if data is your input, we'll be having action as the output. If sensors are there, we can get the data from the sensors. There will be a movement. If images are there, then image to text classification can be one application using the artificial intelligence. But there are different categories of artificial intelligence. They are categorized in three different category. Artificial narrow intelligence is there, ANI, in which the machine intelligence equals or exceed human intelligence at a specific task only. So it can perform only a specific task which we people will ask him to do. But then we are having artificial general intelligence, AGI. Wherein the machine has the ability to apply intelligence to any problem. So in narrow intelligence, it perform only specific tasks, but in general intelligence, it can perform any task, any problem. And then we having the artificial super intelligence, in which the machine can perform the tasks better than the best human brains. And the task involves any task which includes the scientific creativity, general wisdom, as well as social skills also. So these are three categories of artificial intelligence, ANI, AGI, and ASI. And what happens in machine learning? In machine learning, we provide the training with the help of some labeled data. So this labeled data is very important as far as machine learning algorithms are concerned. So we write some algorithms, okay, and then we model the the model is trained with the help of this labeled data and the algorithms. And then if you give it some query image, query data, with the help of this learn model, it will give you prediction or it will give you the classification also. So this machine learning can perform the prediction task as well as the classification task. So this is basic of machine learning. And then how the learning process will be performed in machine learning. So there are three types of learning processes. Supervised learning. In supervised learning, we are having labeled training set. So known data is available with us. And with the help of that, it will give the output as class labels, or it can predict the data. For example, here, email spam detector with the training set of already labeled emails. So we know many times many mails are already transferred to the as a spam. So because of the known training data, it automatically does that. Then in unsupervised learning, there is the data is not labeled already. So depending on patterns or some same information, same characteristics, it group them in different clusters. So example is cluster similar documents based on the text content. So this is what is unsupervised learning. And then we are having third learning process, which is reinforcement learning, wherein learning is based on the feedback or reward. So herein, we can have the positive feedback as well as the negative feedback also. So example, learn to play the chess by winning as well as losing. So winning will also help to improve and losing will also help to improve. So some sort of feedback is required. That feedback may be positive as well as negative. So these three types of learning processes are there with which we can model the machine learning algorithms. So these are a few examples like classification task it can perform. Suppose I want to classify any disease in normal and abnormal, then this linear classification task can be performed by machine learning. Regression, which is used to predict something. Suppose you are given some parameter and then you want to predict the cost of a car or what is the carbon which can be released from the car depending on some parameter. So that's what is done by regression analysis. So it's try to fit in the model. So these are supervised classification, supervised learning. And then we are having clustering. So depending on the characteristics, like here, if we'll use color as a characteristic, so it will group them, or some shape features can be used to group them, because here this is having only red color. So shape features can be used, shape features, color features can be used to group them in different clusters. So this is clustering. And herein, yes, hello.
Hello. Huh. Hello, madam. Audible.
Okay, okay. Then anomaly detection is there, wherein we try to remove the noise from the normal data. So this is also an example of one application of machine learning algorithms. And how it process or how it proceed, like suppose we are having input as a pictures, then what can be the response? We can have the response as are there any human faces? Then the application will be, if it will detect the human faces and then it will tag the photo. We know the best application is Facebook. So in Facebook, wherever you post any picture, so it look for the human faces and automatically it suggests you the names. So that that is one of the example of machine learning. Loan application can be the input, and then it will predict that will they repay the loan or not, depending on all the parameters. The credit score is calculated on the basis of that. The bank will ensure that whether the applicant is in position to repay the loan or not. And then depending on the loan will be approved or not. Then audio clips, if input is audio clips, then we can have transcript as the output. Then in the application will be speech recognition and any language convert translation problems. So if you are given English sentence and then you want to convert it into French sentence, then it has application of language translation. So all this is possible with the help of machine learning. But then comes, what is your deep learning? So deep learning is a machine learning technique that teaches computer to do what comes naturally to humans. And herein, computer model learns to perform classification tasks directly from the images, text, or sound itself. But here, the models are trained by using large set of labeled data. Obviously, neural network architectures are required, but the thing here in deep learning which is required is a large set of labeled data. So that's what is required. And we use a multi-layer neural networks here. But nowadays, we are using deep learning. But why deep learning matters? So the thing is, it achieves recognition accuracy at higher level. That is one advantage. It outperforms human in some tasks like classifying objects in images. But the thing is, it requires large amount of labeled data and substantial computing power. So now as it require large amount of data, so normal CPU is not sufficient for the deep learning algorithms. We will be requiring high performance GPUs with the parallel architecture. And when it is combined with the clusters or cloud computing, then we can reduce the training time from weeks to hours or less. So the thing for deep learning which is required is that we require large label data, large amount of label data and high performance GPUs. But the accuracy with which we can obtain it will be a high level of accuracy. So there are many applications of deep learning, social network filtering. Nowadays we see that in Twitter or Facebook, many times the messages are posted and sometimes they are not appropriate. So in that case, if you want to filter those messages, so there we can use deep learning fraud detection. In image, it plays a vital role. Audio recognition, computer vision, medical image processing, bioinformatics, customer relationship management. These are a few I have cited here, but there are many applications of deep learning. So what differs in machine learning and deep learning? So the basic flow of machine learning is that we'll be having the label data, then we'll extract the features. Some features will be there, and that feature extraction will be a manual process depending on the image. If it is a satellite image, we'll go for different features. If it is a medical images, we'll go for other features. So this step is required if it is machine learning. And then machine learning algorithms will use. And based on those features, there will be a classification. But in deep learning, what happens? The feature extraction and the machine learning and the algorithms, they are combined together. So there is no need to manually extract the features. In deep learning, we use convolutional neural network. So these convolutional neural networks, they itself learn the feature from the image data itself, and then they classify the input data. So that is the basic difference in machine learning and deep learning. So this step is not at all required. There is no need to manually hard code the features from the image data. So when to use machine learning and deep learning? So obviously we know that there is no need of this step, extra step is not required in deep learning, but obviously it is not always possible to use deep learning. So machine learning, it offers a variety of techniques and models based on application, size of data. The size of data is important, and the type of problem. Because if you are not having large amount of data, then we can't go for deep learning. For deep learning, we require large amount of data, thousands of images. So just imagine we require thousands of images. So if you're having data of size only 100, and then we can't go for deep learning. In that case, we must go for machine learning, wherein we need to hard code the features. And also high performance GPUs are also required for deep learning. So depending on your problem statement or availability of data, you can use the algorithms. So deep learning networks, it all started with artificial neural network, a single layer. Then we had multi-layer perceptron. Then comes your convolutional neural network. Now this convolutional neural network is playing a very important role as far as the image processing is concerned. Then recurrent neural networks also there, which are widely used for video processing. Short-term memory, it is also a sub of recurrent neural network. These two networks, they are used for video processing. Generative adversarial network. So this network is, again, they are widely used for in the case of medical images. So basically what happens in medical field, the database is a big problem. So generating the synthetic data is a big issue in medical images. So with generative adversarial network, it is possible to generate the synthetic data, and then we can train the network. So then we have a deep belief network also. So how it works? So just look at the normal fully connected deep neural network, wherein we are having input layer. Then two hidden layers are there and one output layer is there. So if it would have been normal ANN architecture, then we could have been have only one input layer and one output layer. So, but as in between input and output layer, there are hidden layers, two hidden layers. So it is fully connected deep neural network. So in input side, we are having input neurons. And then here some hidden neurons are there. So if suppose fully connected neural network will look for, the trainable parameters which will be required in this case will be n plus 1 into k. So n indicates the number of neurons in the input side, k indicates the number of neurons on the output side, and this one is because of bias. So every time we are having bias here, that bias with the input value as 1. Okay, so let us consider that if your network, fully connected network, is having only one input layer, okay, with 784 neurons, then it is having one hidden layer with 100 neurons, then it is having a second hidden layer with 20 neurons and output layer with 10 neurons. Okay, so now why 784? Suppose, for example, you are working on the image of size 32, 30 by 30. Let us consider 30 by 30. So in all total, we'll be requiring, the total size will be 600. Okay. So this 600 neurons will be required on the input side in that case. So just to have that 784 I have taken. So the trainable parameters which will be required here in that, say 784. So this n is 784 plus 1 into 100. Okay. Again, for 100 plus 1 into 20. Plus 20 plus 1 into 100. So if we'll calculate the trainable parameters, you can see we require 80,730 parameters are to be trained if it is a case of fully connected deep neural network. Okay, so that's a huge cost. So there is a remedy for that, which is convolutional neural network. It's a special kind of multi-layer neural network designed to recognize the visual patterns directly from the pixel images. Okay, and that too with minimal processing, with minimal pre-processing. So convolutional neural networks requires less computation than fully connected deep neural networks. The types of architectures which are possible with CNN architectures, LNNet was the first. It came in 1998. Then LXNet was there. ZFNet, GoogleNet, ResNet, and VGZNet. So all these network architectures, they have used the CNN architecture to improve the accuracy of the deep neural networks. So the basic building blocks of convolutional neural network, any convolutional neural network has these blocks. First will be the convolutional block, then striding is performed, padding, pooling, deconvolution, and then one activation function is used. The mostly used activation function is ReLU, rectified linear, it is a non-linear function, but its derivative is constant, so that's why it is widely used. Now, what happens in convolutional based deep neural network? If suppose you are working on the image which has this size, so the spatial resolution will go on decreasing if we'll go layer by layer. So what happens if suppose this is of size 30 by 30, then after one layer, after convolving it with some small filter, the spatial size reduces, the dimension in XY reduces, but the depth increases in order to restore the complete information. So after having these layers, the width go on increasing. So we can have at last the size of 1 by something like 1000. Okay, so this depth will go on increasing, spatial resolution goes on decreasing. So it is somehow some sort of pyramid structure, or the multi-resolution analysis just we perform in wavelet transform. So the same approach is being used here. The only thing is that here we use a convolutional filter, which is used to downsample the image in X and Y direction. So let us have this. If we are having input image of size M by N, so 3 is here because it is a color image. So RGB planes will be there. And the kernel, which we are using, it will also have 3 channels as that of your input image. And the width and height are W and H. So after, so what will happen? This red channel will convolve with the red channel of this image. This green channel is convolved with the green channel of this. This blue channel will convolve with. That means that dot product will be performed and then summation. So finally, we'll be having only one plane at the output side. And if we are using two such kernels, then we'll be having two channels at the output side. So this size will go on reducing, and we can have this depth. If we go on increasing the number of channels, more number of channels, then we'll be having more number of channels at the output side. You can see here we are using two channels, so that's why this two is there. And what will be the output size? It is m minus w 2 plus 1 by n minus h plus 1. So this step is performed. This step is convolution step. What we do in striding, that filter we apply at the first position, okay? Then whatever value will be after element by element multiplication summation, that value will be assigned to this. The value, whatever value we will calculate, that value is this. Now we'll move, okay? And suppose I am moving only to this, that means I am putting that kernel to this position. That means I moved only by one length, okay? So one pixel movement is there. So that case, I will say that the striding in this case is one, okay? But if suppose instead of moving by one pixel, I am moving by two pixel. So in that case, the striding will be 2. So by how much length you are moving that kernel, that decides your striding. So striding in x direction and striding in y direction. So if you employ use striding, your equation, the output size will be m minus w divided by sw plus 1. Similarly, on this row and columns, n minus h divided by sh plus 1. Okay. So this way, your output size will differ depending on how much length you are traversing in x direction and in y direction. Then comes your padding. If I want to include all the elements in that case, so suppose here one row at top and one row at bottom is there, one column at left, and we have padded one column at the right. And normally zero padding is performed. So how many rows you're adding and how many columns you're adding. So depending on that, you will get the output. So in that case, size of output image will differ and the formula will be this. So this two PW will be added over here. So compared to previous equation, herein only we added twice PW. So if all this are performed like convolution, then striding and padding, then this will be your final equation, which will give you the output, which will give you the size of the output image. So this is what after performing convolution with stride and padding. So after that, the next step is pooling operation. So this pooling is nothing but the downsampling operation which is performed. So this is your input image in case, and I'm using the size of pooling as 2x2, suppose. So for this 2x2 image, and we can use max pooling, we can use average pooling, we can use mean pooling also, we can use median pooling. So it depends on what type of pooling you want to perform. So if I'll perform max pooling, then in this 2x2, whatever maximum value, that value will be assigned. So this 11 is assigned here. And then again, here in this 2x2, the maximum value is 14. So this 14 is here. Now see here, the striding which I have used is I'm moving by 2 pixels. So initially I was at this location and then I moved by 2 pixel. Okay, so here the striding of 2 was used. Okay, so this is simple max pooling, and in average pooling, what we'll do, we'll take the average. So in this 2x2, whatever is the average of this pixel, 10 plus 11 plus 9 plus 7 divided by 4. So that average value will be assigned here. So this is the average pooling. But here, what type of sliding we are used? We are moved by a distance of 2 pixels. And that's why the size was 2x2. Now, if I will move by only 1 pixel, okay. So what was there? Initially, I was at this location. Okay. And suppose I'm using the max pulling. So the maximum value is 10. So this 10 will, maximum value is 11. This 11 is here. Okay. And now, I am moving by only 1 pixel. Okay. So instead of going to this location, I'm going at this location. So this, so at this place, the maximum value is 13. So this 13 is assigned here. Okay. Now again, I will move by one pixel. So I'll be having this 2x2. So the maximum value is 14. So this 14 is assigned here. So this is what is pulling with stride. Stride of 1. In previous example, it was a stride of 2 only. And we can find out the size of output images simply by using this formula. If we'll put in all those values, m equal to 4, the kernel size which we use was 2x2, then stride of 1, then we'll get the size of 3x3. And which type of pulling we use? Max pulling. So this is how the operations are being performed in CNN, convolutional neural network. And then after it, we can have flattening and then a ReLU activation function. So this is what ReLU activation function looks. It has the non-linearity at this location, but if we'll take the derivative is constant. So what type of notations are used in convolutional neural network? Okay. So you will see if one complete CN network is there, CNN there, then this we can see this 6C, 5W, 1S and 0P. So the meaning is that at the output side, we want 6 channels. That means we are convolving the input image with the 6 kernels, 6 channels of size 5x5. The kernel size width and height is 5x5. What is the striding we are using? We are moving by a 1 pixel length distance and padding is 0. Means 0 in the sense no rows and no columns are added. Okay. So padding of 0 is there. So this is what the notations are used in CNN. Now let us see an example. Suppose your first layer is this convolutional neural network. The convolutional layer is there, 6C7, W, 0P and 1S. So the meaning will be what? I am convolving the input image with 6 channels or 6 kernels of size 7x7. Padding I am using 0 and striding of 1. So let us consider you have the input image of size 32x32 and it's a color image. So at the input we'll be having 3 channels. So this is simple, MNR32, C will be 3 in this case, W and 7, what is the size? Size of kernel is 7 and then at the output, I will be getting 6 channels because I'm convolving it with 6 kernels, so padding 0 and SW. So by using that formula, the final formula, I will be getting the size of output tensor will be 26x20 just by putting all those values. Okay. And you can clearly see that at the input was 3 channels only, but as we are convolving it with 6 kernels, so this 6 will come here. Okay. Now at the output, we are having 26x26 and 6 kernels. Now you can clearly see the spatial resolution goes on decreasing, but the width goes on increasing. In order to retain those information, we increase the width. So after that, I'm going for max pooling. Okay. And max pooling, I'm using width of kernel of 2x2, striding of 2 and padding 0. Okay. So what will be the output in this case? So after convolutional layer, the output was this 26x26 into 6. So this will be input to my max pool layer, 26x26 into 6. Then, so by putting all those again in that equation, I'm getting the size of 13x13. Okay. Now, the kernel filter will remain same. Here, we are not convolving it. Here, we are just performing the max pooling. So, the kernel size will remain same. Okay, so, you can clearly see now, it is 13 by 13 into 6. So, after max pooling, the next operation is ReLU function, activation function. So, it will not change the size. It will, as it is, 13 by 13 into 6 will be input and output will be again 13 by 13 into 6. And then the next layer is flattening layer. That means we are converting it into one-dimensional array. So, all this will be multiplied. So, we'll be having 1 by 1014 image. Okay. So, here you can see the parameters which will be required in convolutional neural network. They are not depended on the input image size. Okay. If this would have been the fully connected neural network, then the parameters would have been 32 by 32, and then next in layer would have been there. But in CNN, the parameters, they are independent on the size of input image. It depends only on the channels. So the parameters, which trainable parameters which we required in CNN, they are very less as compared to the fully connected neural network. So this is how the complete flow works as far as the CNN convolutional neural networks are there. Now, where we can find, so basically this ImageNet projects that runs an every year, that runs an annual software contest, which is known as ImageNet Large Scale Visual Recognition Challenges, where the software programs compute to correctly classify and detect the object and sees. So as I told you, LeNet was the first network which used a convolutional neural network. And it recognized handwritten numbers on checks digitized in 32 by 32 pixel grayscale images. After that, AlexNet was there. So AlexNet, in AlexNet, the accuracy or the error of classifying the object was reduced from 26% to 15.3%. So this much accurate was it. Then ZF won that competition with the error rate of 14.8%. Now we can say nowadays GoogleNet and Inception networks are there. They use convolutional neural network. The error rate is only 6.67%. And then ResNet in 2015, the error rate is only 3.57%. So we can see we are having all these networks which gives us the very high accuracy with less error, and that's why they are shifting towards the medical image processing, because in medical image processing, we require error should be as minimum as possible. That means 3% is not also not acceptable in medical images, but then also we can use them for medical images. So if you see the markets scenario and the career opportunities in medical field, medical image analysis, so we can see that 63% of the globe, they cover media applications, surveillance application, automotive and graphics. So nearly $6 billion market is there. But single only medical image processing, it covers 37% of the entire globe. Nearly 3.5 billion market share is there for medical image analysis only. And this is a report of markets and markets.com, I referred from it. So where we can go for it now? So what type of modalities we can use? We can use, there are X-ray images are there, ultrasound images are there, computer tomography, magnetic resonance imaging, the nuclear imaging, PET and SPECT is there. So we can go for all this image database. Then clinical conditions are radiology, cardiology, oncology, neurology is there, obstetrics and gynecology, breast mammography is available. And what will be the end users for our products? Hospitals, diagnostic centers will be there, research centers also there. So we can see a good career option is available and in the field of medical image analysis. And as far as health sector is concerned, the interpretation of medical data is done by medical experts only. But what will be the limitations is due to subjectivity because it varies from person to person. Then complexity of the images, because we'll see the ultrasound images, they are having very few information, and the signal to noise ratio is very high in such images, echocardiography images. And then extensive variations exist across the different interpretation, because different interpreters. Because if we'll show one image to one expert and the same image is being shown to another expert, there will be a interperson variation in the diagnosis. And then fatigue is also one cause which fatigue is also there, which causes the problem in the health sector. So this here, this is ultrasound image, and if you'll go for automatic liver segmentation from the ultrasound image images. So what will be our goal as far as the medical professional is concerned? The goal is automated functional analysis of heart, the improve workflow, reduce user variability. But the challenge here is that these types of images, US images, ultrasonography images, echocardiography images, they're having very low signal to noise ratio. And you can see the ages are not clearly visible. And also the training set, data set is also a problem as far as this US medical image is concerned. Next is hippocampus segmentation. Here you can see this portion is hippocampus. And why it is important? Because the volume of this hippocampus is very important for the early diagnosis of neurological diseases like Alzheimer's is there, schizophrenia, dementia, and very small research is going on in this area in neurological diseases, especially Alzheimer's. So this is also very important. But the challenge here is that the size of hippocampus is very small. It is of 35 by 15 by 7 mm cube. And the hippocampus is surrounded by a very complex structure. That's what, so it's very hard to segment this hippocampus. And the low resolution of these images. If we'll use 1.5 Tesla and 3 Tesla MRI scanners, then the resolution of images is very less. But nowadays, the 7 Tesla machines are available, but they are very costly. So if we'll provide algorithms which works well on these types of images, which are the images which are captured through 1.5 Tesla and 3 Tesla, then it gives us the better opportunity in these areas. So deep learning in medical images. So what we can do here, we are having various sources of images like X-ray, CT, MRI scan, pathology images are there. And the image diagnosis requires the initial search to identify the abnormalities. So this is important, early diagnosis. Early diagnosis is very important in the medical professional. And the quantification is also required, because what happens if we'll, as far as medical professional is concerned, they observe the images, and that is a qualitative approach. And what is required there? Somehow if we'll provide them some quantitative measurement, that is very helpful to them. And what changes occur during the time. So suppose some infection is there, and if we are in a position to find out the post-operative infections. So that is also very important in medical profession. So application of deep learning in healthcare covers the broad range. It ranges from cancer screening to disease monitoring and to personalized treatment suggestion also. So again, that will be another help to medical professional. That means we are not overcoming, we are not challenging them, but it will be a assistance to the medical professionals. So now, what are the challenges which occur in the medical image processing? So first is unavailability of data set and dedicated medical experts. So basically what happens, the classification accuracy of deep learning classifiers is largely dependent on the quality and the size of data set. And it requires multiple experts' opinion to overcome the human error. But unavailability of the medical or qualified experts or availability of sufficient cases, like if suppose there are rare diseases, then it's an issue in medical image field. And the unbalancing of data is very common in this health sector, like rare diseases. Then next is it requires extensive inter-organization collaboration. So collaboration between hospitals, vendors, and deep learning scientists is extensively required. And this collaboration will solve the problem of data, because if the collaboration is there, definitely the data can be generated. The next is privacy and legal issues. This is very important as far as medical field is concerned, because it is much complicated and it is very difficult to share the medical data as compared to the real world data. And data privacy is effectively, it is both sociological as well as the technical issue. There are a few acts which provides the legal rights to the patients, and it also establishes some obligations for the healthcare providers and protect and restrict its use and its disclosure. The acts are Health Insurance Portability and Accountability Act. So that acts preserves the rights of the patients. Then data interoperability and data standards are there. Currently what happens means the nature of data differs from hardware to hardware, and there exists a large variation in the images due to sensors and other factors. Means depending on sensor quality, the nature of data will differ. And to achieve interoperability level, the health standardization bodies define some standards and guidelines. So there are some certifications are there, some which standardize the data. One certification is Certification Commission for Health Information Technology. And second is American Recovery and Reinvestment Act. So these are used to evaluate the complete system of data standardization. And the most important issue is black box. Now, this is biggest issue. Why we say it is biggest issue? Because though lots of mass is involved in convolutional neural network or in deep neural network, but of machine learning algorithm, but how we get output, that is again unknown, or it's very complicated. Like algorithms gets a bunch of data as input, it identifies the pattern, and then build predictive model and then give some output. But how it does it, again a issue as far as machine learning and deep learning algorithms are concerned. So though there are some challenges and some problems are there, but open research issues are there and some future directions are there. So three trends that drives the deep learning revolution are availability of big data. So we are saying that there is a problem of data, but then also collaboration is already established, and that's why the data is available. Recent deep learning algorithms are there. Just now we saw that Google Net and ZFNet, they are having the accuracy, they're having the error rate of only 3% and 6%. So nowadays these deep learning algorithms are evolving by themselves. Processing power, GPUs, CUDA software are there. So everything is possible now. Siemens, Philips, Hitachi, and GE Healthcare, they have already made significant investment in the medical field. Then IBM Watson is working with more than 15 healthcare sectors. So that way more image data is being generated. Google DeepMind Health is collaborating with NSHUK to apply deep learning on different healthcare applications, the data set of 1.6 million patients. You just imagine 1.6 million patients means how much the data will be made available to us. GE Healthcare has already partnered with the Boston Children Hospitals. It's working on the smart imaging technology for detecting pediatric brain disorder. So this is very important for sudden infant death syndrome. So they are working on that. So now where we can go for the medical image processing means from where to start if I want to do research in this field. So there are many options are available. This field, diabetic retinopathy, it is very evolving. So diabetic retinopathy is an eye disease which causes due to diabetes and it results in eye blindness. And almost 415 million people, they are suffering from diabetes in the world. And 15% among them have high risk of vision impairment, blindness and loss. But this disease can be controlled if we'll go for early diagnosis. So if it is detected at the early stage by retinal screening, then this can be controlled. But the problem here is that the manual process of detection of this diabetic retinopathy is very difficult and it is time consuming process due to the unavailability of equipment and the expertise. So the equipment which is used for this retinopathy is very costly. And that's why there is a time lag and especially in rural areas. So it causes a problem. So where we can contribute here? So the abnormality which we can detect in diabetic retinopathy images is hemorrhages through images, fundus images. These are the fundus images, abnormal growth of blood vessels, aneurysm, cotton wool spots and hard exudate. But the problem is that these symptoms, they are not clearly shown at the early stages. And the clinicians need to examine the color fundus images of the retina. But as these are not detected at the early stage, there is a delay in the treatment and miscommunication and then the loss of follow-ups there. But if suppose we'll develop good machine learning or deep learning algorithms to detect all these abnormalities at the early stage itself, then it will be a great assistance to the medical professional. So from where we can start now? We want the image database for that case. So database which is available for retina fundus images, sir, IPACS is there, eye picture archives communication system. It has approximately 10,000 retinal images. So already labeled database is there, so we can work on that. Medisor 2 dataset, it contains 1700 images that are collected from 874 patients. And then Kaggle, nowadays it is very famous Kaggle, publicly available dataset is there. It has 80,000 digital images, digital fundus images. Drive and Stare is also there. So these databases, they are widely used by the researcher. And then every year retinopathy online challenge is there wherein the data set is provided. They ask for us, they ask to develop the algorithms. Everything is provided, data set, ground truth, everything is provided. And our aim is to develop the algorithm with higher accuracy and less error rate. And then these two are the data set is also there. So lots of opportunities there in this area. The next gastrointestinal disease detection. This is also one of the vital area of research. Basically, these diseases, they are classified in different categories like celiac, Crohn, malignant, benign tumor, intestinal obstruction, duodenal ulcer, irritable bowel syndrome, etc. And so that means here we required the multi-class classification. Basically what happens in medical images, only the classification problem is limited to only binary, that means normal and abnormal. But if we'll develop the algorithms which gives you the multi-class classification, then that is very important. Means it will be a great help in this area, in the area of medical image field. So image processing and machine learning can play a vital role here for diagnosing and analyzing these diseases and the help of the doctors in making fast decisions and treatment effectively and accurately. So from where we can get the database? So data set is there, GI 10,000 wireless capsule endoscopy, WC images for detection of bleeding is there. ImageNet dataset, MRI sequences are there. So if you just search on Google, ImageNet dataset for this endoscopy images or gastrointestinal images, we can get the MRI sequences. Now this pandemic has given very scope for given the problem as well as some scope for working also. So COVID X-ray, chest X-ray data set is there. It contains the data, a set of images from the publications of COVID-19 topics. GitHub, on the GitHub it is available. And this data set contains a mix of chest X-ray as well as CT images. And the codes are also available in this GitHub directory. CHESPER dataset, it's a large public dataset for chest radiograph interpretation, consisting of 24,316 chest radiograph of nearly 65,000 patients. Then they are labeled for presence of 14 subcategories, like no edema, edema, and no pneumonia. No, we know pneumonia is the cause for COVID, and that's why they have put in this data for the classification purpose. So this data set is also available. And what we observe that if in many good journals, what they have done, they have simply applied some deep neural network, done some analysis, and some findings are there. And then also the paper is published in very good quality journals, like Medical Image Analysis is there. So as this is hot topics for today, so if we'll contribute in some way also, it is very much possible to publish your work. Then Alzheimer disease, this is also very important because very less attention is being paid in this area. This disease is incurable neurodegenerative disorder. It is accounting for 70-80% of dementia cases worldwide. So basically, in Alzheimer, the research is only limited to binary classification. That means normal and abnormal. But in Alzheimer, there are many stages. So the stages are cognitively normal, significant memory concern, SMC, early mild cognitive impairment, then mild cognitive impairment, large mild cognitive impairment, and Alzheimer disease. So there are this is a multi-class problem. But as I told you, the research in AD is limited only binary classification. So lots of opportunities there in this neurodegenerative disorders. If we'll develop the algorithms, machine learning or deep learning, which will classify the disease in the subcategories, then that will be a great help to the society. So from where we can get the data set? So this ADNI protocol is there, Alzheimer's Disease Neuroimaging Initiative. We need to submit some proposal, small proposal to this ADNI, and then they give access to this data. And these data set is having all these categories of images. Then Pennsylvania University Image Calculation and Science Laboratories, there we can find the database. And University of Utah Scientific Calculation and Imaging Institute. So for Alzheimer's, these are the sources of database. Now, what metrics, evaluation metrics we can use once you develop the algorithms, machine learning algorithms, on basis of which you can compare your algorithm that, yes, this is the good algorithm. So first is Jaggard index, similarity index, confusion matrix is there, accuracy, precision and recall, and then F1 score. So these are few which I have cited here. There are other also, RAND index is there, Dias coefficient is also there. So with which we can evaluate our algorithms. So Jaggard similarity, it gives the similarity index between the actual, that means your output, that means the ground truth and your output predicted labels. So this is the formula. It is basically a ratio of intersection to union. And this is written in this way also. So the range of similarity, Jaggard similarity, it will be always in the range of 0 to 1. So 0 will indicate that there is no similarity at all. And 1 will indicate that there is a similarity in the actual output and predicted output. So I mean, that means whatever is the ground truth, the same is out, same output is been obtained by your algorithms. So the range is 0 to 1. So 1 means high accuracy and 0 means there is no at all matching. Then this confusion matrix is widely used in medical field. Suppose it is a binary classification problem, that means normal and abnormal. Then we'll be having the truth value here on this side and the, your results. So these four parameters will be calculated. That is true positive. That means your result is also positive and the truth is also saying that it is positive. Then false positive, that means you are saying it is positive, but truth is saying that it is not positive. So false positive, false negative, and true negative. So these four parameters are there. And by using these four parameters, we can calculate positive predictive value, which is also called as recall, and negative precision value by using TN. And then sensitivity and specificity. So by using these four parameters, TP, FE, FN, and TN, we can evaluate the performance of your algorithm. So again, here it is mentioned, true positive means predictive values correctly predicted as actual positive. False positive means predicted values incorrectly predicted as an actual positive, that is a negative values predicted as positive. False negative, positive values predicted as negative, so that will be a false negative. And true negative, predicted values are correctly predicted as actual negative. So this, if you are getting TP and TN good, then that means your work algorithm is good. So as an example, let us have, these are the actual results. For binary classification, we are saying it as normal and abnormal in case. So P will refer as normal and N as refer as abnormal. Or in the case of, I'm saying that P means non-cancerous and F means cancerous. So these are, let us consider we're having actual result. And these are the predicted results by your algorithm. So herein, predicted actual result was P, and you also predicted P, so that's why it is true positive. But what will be a false negative? Actual result was positive, but you are saying it as negative, then it will be false negative. Similarly, actual result is negative and you are saying it is positive, then it will be a false positive. So this is how these parameters will be calculated. So how many TP I am having? TP are 2, then FN. So these values are calculated, and by using TP, TN, FP, and FN, I can calculate the sensitivity and specificity. Now, accuracy is also one of the classification metrics. It is suited for binary as well as the multi-class classification. So this is the formula. So by calculating all those TP, TN, FP, and FN, I can calculate the accuracy of my system or of my algorithm. So accuracy is the proportion of true results among the total number of cases which has been examined. And now next is precision. This we can also use precision now, but when to use precision? Now precision is the valid choice of evaluation matrix when we want to be very sure, means whatever prediction we are doing, if we want to be very sure, then we can go for precision. Now, for example, if you are building a system to predict if we should decrease the credit limit on a particular account, or we want to be very sure in that case. So otherwise it may result in customer dissatisfaction. So in that case, we can go for precision. So again, this precision has been calculated by using the this TP and FP. And then recall is there, the what proportion of actual positive is correctly classified. So if you want only the number, in that case, we can go for recall. So recall is a valid choice of evaluation matrix when we want to capture as many positive values. Okay, so surety is not required here. You want to just check it how many positives you obtain. For example, if we are building a system to predict if a person has a cancer or not, we want to capture the disease even if we are not very sure. So just we want to capture the disease in that case. In that case, we can use recall. So again, by using TP, FP, TPT, and FN, we can calculate the recall. And then this FN score is there, which balances out in between precision and recall. It's a harmonic mean of precision and recall. So its value is in between 0 to 1. So F1 is calculated by using precision and recall. So now these are the open researches, means we can go for like I told you about the diabetic retinopathy, then Alzheimer's. I cited only four or five areas wherein we can go for medical image processing. But they are not only those. If you want to really see where we can go for research, then this grand challenge is biomedical image analysis is there. If you click on here, will get the entire information when that challenge has been opened. They provide the data set, the entire data set is provided. And there are many areas like city images. For city images, there is a different images. There is a different challenge. For MRI images, there is a different challenge. For other images. So various challenges are there. They provide us the data set, ground truths, everything. And we need to submit there the algorithms with the proper result by evaluating your algorithm by all those parameters like Jacquard index, everything, whatever you can use, you can use to evaluate the your algorithm, and then you can submit your algorithms to their challenges. So lots of opportunities is there in this field, biomedical image processing, biomedical image analysis, and you can go through this site, grandchallenges.org, and all challenges will get all the information. Then this is one community, Kaggle, machine learning and data science community. So you can be a part of this community wherein they are having the data set as well as the codes are also available. We people can also contribute to this community. We just need to log in by your Google account and then you can become the community person of this Kaggle. And there also, there are a few competitions, like we need to provide, the data set is available. The only thing is that data set is available. We need to just write the, develop the algorithms and then us provide or contribute from our side. Now, which type of toolboxes we can use for this analysis? Anaconda is there with Python 3.7 scientific computing laboratory for custom building tools. For specially deep learning algorithms, PyTorch, we can use PyTorch. MATLAB is also the matrix laboratory for scientific computing tool. So recently, all these toolboxes are added over there, machine learning, deep learning. So as such, there is no hard coding is required for writing the code. The only thing is that we should be in a position to explain it mathematically. It means though the mathematics is available, we should be able to explain the computational complexity of the network analysis. We should be in a position to carry out the analysis, and then we can publish a good paper in these areas. Then CUDA library for using NVIDIA GPUs there. So these are the toolboxes of the trade which we can use for medical image processing. Where to read for ML and DL? So these are some specific journals like IEEE Transactions on Pattern Analysis, Machine Learning. The high standard journals, Machine Learning, Journal Machine Learning Research, IEEE Transaction on Knowledge and Data Engineering, IEEE Transaction on Neural Network, System and Cybernetics is there. So these are very high standard journals where you can find the good papers of machine learning and deep learning. And also the conferences, CVPR is there, ICML, ECML, SCML, NIPS. All these conferences are very, very high reputed conference And if we'll refer the papers of these conferences, we'll get the great insight for the research in this area of machine learning and deep learning. Computer vision conferences are there, ICCV, ECCV, Asian, European, and international also. Where to listen and socialize all those. So these are a few workshops and school conferences. So this Indian conference on computer vision, graphics and image processing. So very good conference every year. Right? And then this national conference. So this was all about the machine learning and deep learning in medical field, how we can proceed for medical image analysis with the help of machine learning and deep learning. Now I want to discuss one case study which we developed for brain tumor type detection. So basically magnetic resonance imaging, they plays a very important role in the diagnosis of brain tumor and its type. So what happens in brain analysis, the research was limited to only segmentation, and then it was then processed for the classification of tumor into benign and malignant only. So we are having this tumor type as benign, which is a slow growing non-cancerous, and it do not spread to surrounding tissues. And the malignant tumor, which is cancerous, it is fast growing and aggressive. So research was limited to only this classification of benign and malignant. But the requirement here is that we should be in a position to classify the type of tumor also, so that there are many types of tumor, the astrocytoma, glioma, meningioma. There are other types also, but that research is not been evolved so far. So again, in astrocytoma, there is a grade-wise, grade 1, grade 2, grade 3, grade 4 is also there. So here in this field also, there is a lot of opportunity for biomedical, means developing the algorithms for the classification of this tumor type and then grade of the tumor also. So we just tried to contribute in some way in this case. But again, the problem which we faced was the data of the data from the hospitals. But we tried to get some data from the hospitals, and then we tried some algorithm to classify the brain tumor type in two classes only. So the flow was very simple, means that the same flow which we people always use for medical image processing, image, then pre-processing, segmentation, feature extraction, and then depending on the feature extraction, we classify the images as one type or another type. So we obtain these database from the hospitals. These are the real images of brain. These were not the synthetic images which we obtain. Then we need to go for pre-processing, because here you can see the brain, they are surrounded by this cerebral tissues. This non-cerebral tissues. So our main task was to remove the skull portion. So for that purpose, we done the Gaussian filtering in order to remove the noise from the image. Then mask is created by using some thresholding operation and morphology operation, like dilation, erosion, and everything. And then this mask has been created. So this mask was overlapped on the input image. And then I can see this was the output image, which is skull-shaped image. So this non-cerebral portion was removed from the brain images. So now we are having only cerebral tissues, which is white matter, gray matter, and cerebrospinal fluid, and some tumor portion of the image. So our aim was to classify this tumor, whether it's the tumor is of one type or other type. So depending on the data which we obtain only a few data images of only few brain tumor types, and that's why we developed the algorithm. So the next step was segmentation. We need to segment out that tumor portion. So for that purpose, we use stationary wavelet transform. And then features are extracted, like energy features, standard deviation, mean axis deviation was calculated from that image. And then self-organizing map and watersheds. These are a few standard segmentation algorithms were there, which is used to segment out this tumor portion. So once the tumor has been segmented, The next task was to identify the type of the tumor, whether it's a meningioma type or it's a glioma type. So we could have obtained only these two images, more images of meningioma and glioma. That's why we just concentrated on these two types only. So after segmentation of that tumor, we went for a feature extraction. So we extracted the gray level co-occurrence features like contrast, correlation, energy and homogeneity. And depending on those feature values, we perform the classification. So support vector machine was used to classify the tumor type into meningioma and glioma. So these were the data set. You can see here, we could have obtained only 90 images for the testing of this algorithm. So this is how the case study, the study of brain tumor type segmentation was carried out. So herein also you're having lots of scope for the research, because see, we have used only two types of brain tumor type. There are various types, like astrocytoma is there. Other than that, many other types of brain tumor type. If you could obtain all those images with the different tumor types, then you can develop the algorithm, and that publication will lead to that research will lead to fast publication, because not a lot of work is been done in that area. And again, if you'll go for the grade detection, like in astrocytoma, the grades are grade 1, grade 2, grade 3, grade 4. So if we'll detect the grade through image processing only, that would be also very helpful, or it will be a great assistance to the medical professional in this area. So this is what from my side. So I finished my presentation. So if hello.
Hello.
Hello, madam. Yes, sir. Okay, madam. So this is what from my side is there.
Okay, madam. Myself, Dr. S. T. Wagar.
Yes, sir.
EATC department. Okay. Madam, some questions from audience.
Yes, sir.
Question number one is difference in implementation of CNN and DNN.
Difference in implementation of CNN and?
DNN. DNN.
Deep neural network, they want to say?
Maybe neural network. Okay.
Okay. Sir, CNN is a part of DNN. Means in deep neural network, we can have only fully connected layers also. But in CNN, what we do, we have the filters, and that filters convolved with the input images. So that is what main difference is. That means in DNN, we can have only fully connected layer. But in CNN, the convolutional layer is there. And that reduces the computational complexity. I hope I could answer. Hello?
What is the meaning of regression in machine learning?
Yes, regression is used to predict. In machine learning, we are having supervised learning processes, classification and regression. So in classification, we just do the classification. If some input data is there, we classify it in one class and two class. But in regression, what we do, we predict the output. I mean, suppose something is given, some parameters are given, then we predict its value. Suppose there are a few parameters related to cars are given, then we will be in a position to predict the price of car. So that is what is regression analysis is called.
Okay. Another question is, where we will get brain tumor data set, and what is the data set size required for training and testing purpose?
Yeah, brain IBSR data is there. McGill database is there for brain image analysis, and if you want to go for Alzheimer, then ADNI protocols is there. So all these databases available, and the site which I have given you, grand challenges, over there also they provide medical image data, MRI images, magnetic resonance images of brain. So for MRI images, lots of databases there. And data size, sir, it is not, means we can't say perfectly. If your algorithm will give you good results with less error rate, then that much is sufficient. But if as far as medical images is concerned, we should use more labeled database.
How regression analysis useful time series?
Pardon?
How regression analysis useful time series?
Time saving?
Series. Time series. Thank you very much, madam. Good morning, one and all. I, Dr. S. C. Vagas, on behalf of Rajarshi Shahu College of Engineering, Tathode, Pune, extends a very hearty vote of thanks to dynamic personality Dr. Yogita Chitriv for sharing her valuable thoughts. Madam, thank you very much for exploring building blocks of CNN, deep learning in medical images, biomedical applications, then market for machine vision system in 2020, open research issues and future directions, diabetic retinopathy and brain tumor type detection. This session has given informative in this regard. Thank you very much, madam.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, participants, for this, for your patience learning. Thank you, all of you.
Over to Jessica, madam. Hello. Hello, Rajesh, sir. Okay, madam. This session
yes,
is over.
Yes, sir. Shall I leave? Yes.
Yes, madam. Okay. Thank you.
Okay.
Hello. Rajesh, sir.
Okay, yes, sir. Yes,
sir. What is time of next session?
11:45. Next session will start around 11:45 a.m.
Okay.
Yes.
Oh, no. Rajesh, sir, am I audible?
Yes, ma'am.
You are audible.
Mosmi madam is joining now. You just make her a post. As soon as
you join. I'm here, ma'am. I'm here.
Okay. Good morning. How are you? Mosmi madam?
Hello, ma'am.
Yes, yes. Good morning.
Yes, ma'am.
So we'll start.
Yes, ma'am.
Shraddha, madam.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. You may start. I welcome all to session 2 for the day. The speaker for today is Dr. Mausumi Munot ma'am, Associate Professor, Department of ENTC, PICT, Pune. Ma'am has a PhD in Electronics and Telecommunication Engineering from College of Engineering, Pune. Ma'am has 70 plus years of teaching experience. Her area of interest are machine learning, deep learning, biomedical image processing. Ma'am has done funded research work in project entitled Smart Food Classification and Grading System, project sanctioned by BCUD SPPU Pune, sanction amount of 1,50,000. Project entitled Development of Automated System for Cytogenic Analysis and Classification. Principal Investigator, Research Project funded by Department of Science and Technology with amount of 6,72,000. Ma'am has various honors and awards to her credit. To list a few, ma'am is a topper in NPTEL course in the course Ethics in Engineering and Practice in 2019. Also, ma'am is a topper in NPTEL course of Introduction to Machine Learning 2019. Fellowship from Indian National Academy of Engineering for research work under Dr. Jayant Mukhopadhyay, Department of Computer Science, IIT Kharagpur, India. DST ITS to present a research paper at IIT Image Processing Conference, London, 2012. Also, ma'am is a rank holder for standing first during her MTech in COEP. Ma'am has 4 patents and copyrights to her credit. She is also a reviewer to reputed journals like IEEE, System Man and Cybernetics, Springer Medical and Biological Engineering Computing, Springer Journal of Medical Sciences, IET Image Processing, Journal of Kingsford University, Computer and Information Sciences. Ma'am is an expert for PhD progress monitoring. Also, she is a recognized research guide in SPPU. External expert for PhD process monitoring, progress monitoring committee at Department of ENTC VIIT Research Center. Department of ENTC Engineering, BVCOE Research Center, and Department of ENTC AISSMS IoT Center, Research Center. She has international book and book chapters to her credit, that is Research Methodology, A Practical and Scientific Approach, CRC Press, Plagiarism Chapter 7, Research Methodology, A Practical and Scientific Approach. She has delivered expert talks on various topics. To list a few, image processing chromosome analysis, diagnostic methods for sustainable sediment management in reservoirs and rivers, machine learning by MATLAB implementation, deep learning techniques, and many more. Ma'am, on behalf of JSPM's Rajarshi Shahu College of Engineering and Department of Electronics and Telecommunication, I, Shraddha Bengaldive, welcome you, ma'am.
Thank you so much, Shraddha madam. Thanks a lot for this very warm welcome and a very nice introduction. I'm just trying to learn in all this due journey of my PhD as well as a case study that matches well with your topic. And I'm here to share something very little that I have learned and I'm still learning. So let's get started. I'll share my screen. I hope I am clearly audible.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Yeah. So a warm welcome to all the learned audience, all of you, for this session in the given STTP that is being arranged by our team at JSPMS, and I congratulate you for your efforts, you know, to ensure a value addition amongst all of us. So thank you so much to your organizing team before we start. Let's get started. So this STTP is on artificial intelligence and its applications in biomedical engineering. And we will deal with a typical test case of chromosome analysis, which has been my research topic. And I will like to strike a balance of telling you all the do's and don'ts during your research, as well as telling you all the technical terms and trying to help you by sharing all the experiences that I had during my PhD, so that at the end of this session, I hope I can give you the best I had and it helps you during your career. So let's get started with a typical test case of research in biomedical engineering and the research in this particular domain. Yeah. So the topic of my PhD was automated pattern recognition for chromosome analysis. And this is the outline of the presentation where we will speak about how did I finalize this topic. And this particular complete part of chromosome, how did I arrive at it, and do's and don'ts when you decide the topic, you finalize the scope, and then what is the little work that I contributed, and what are the future directions, so that you get some points for your PhD topic, as most of you are aspirants, is what I learned from the organizers. So this is what I plan for the next 1 hour. So basically, the most important part in PhD is how do I identify a solvable problem? And this word, solvable problem, is very important when you work on your PhD topics. So even if you have decided a topic, even if you have identified a problem statement, how do you mold it to bring it to us? How do you identify that solvable dimension, and which should throughout your research ensure the required research component? So I did start initially with a problem statement in VLSI, and then we did have Subbarao Madam in Sangli, who was guiding me, and I was very enthusiastic and interested. And then I realized that I need the resources which are not available readily with my college or even with the research center. And for every experimentation that back then in 2007, that's when I started my work. So back then, I for every experimentation and for these tools on Tanner and Cadence, I'll have to go twice where I think. I'll have to pay there and I'll have to travel all the way and then come down to the results. So that is something which I really found challenging regardless of my interest in the topic. So it so happens that in the beginning, it is the topic that drives us, but it's a humble request to always remember resources and your doability, and doability with ease. It's not only how you can do it, but then how conveniently you can do it. Because ultimately what matters and what will be counted is your contribution. And I telling that I have traveled 2 hours every day to experiment does not make me a good researcher. So researcher in sense does not make me very smart at what I'm doing unless and until it is do or die. So when we finalize the problem statement, the most important part is the problem solvable, first part. The second most important part is, does it have the required research component in it? So we all need the research components in our research that we have identified. And throughout, we have to always remember that we That is the whole thing in PhD. And towards the end of this journey of 4 hours, sorry, 4 years, 3 years or 5 years, I need to show the concrete or substantial contribution. So when choosing a topic, we need to remember this, that the problem is solvable with good resources that are readily available, and all my energy I should utilize it in experimentation, then in making the resources available. So this is what is the most important part, and that's where I did literally give a period, a pause, a break to my interests in VLSI, and I did move down to altogether a new dimension of biomedical imaging, and that's how I did take this initiative. And then this topic of biomedical imaging was given by my respected guide, Dr. Madhuri Joshi, who is like now an emeritus professor at COAP. Ma'am has retired, but it is by her virtue I could finalize this domain. So I was just told that, Mosmi, let's pick up something from medical imaging. And then again, the next part of my journey started from this part, wherein at this point, I made it a point of moving down to so many doctors, having words and discussions with them. And again, the most important part is identifying a problem which is identifying a problem which makes sense, and which always research component in that problem is always catered and identified and ignified throughout the 4 years down the line. At the first place, I went down to cancer research, and I did see the global status, wherein now I introduce you to the third most important point, that you need to take a look at what is the global status, what is the national and the international status of the problem statement that you are identifying. And that's where I had to again restart my journey, because when it did come to cancer research, which was identifying a cancer at the early stage, that is what was the problem that at hand, which again fascinated me. For the second time, I was interested in that particular problem. But then looking at the international status, we have this lab in cancer research, which is run by Dr. Asha Multani, and I did get in touch with Madam, and the exhaustive work in terms of publications and in terms of their patents and in terms of their products that was going on, I was again on back foot, because if this is where the world in medical imaging is processing, how am I going to end up contributing to it in terms of good publications or IPR? That was again a million-dollar question, which left me with a discouraging answer, to be honest with all of you. And then I again restarted my quest for searching the topic. This is what brought me to the second or the third, in fact, point, wherein digital X-ray is what I went ahead with. And then there, after many discussions with the doctors, I realized that there is very less to do in terms of identifying or processing a digital X-ray. And the research which doctors expect is like in terms of that equipment and bringing down its cost. And that is where once again I was on back foot, because doing research in the products or in devices was not something which I could easily do given my limited knowledge and again the limited resources that we have in and around Pune. So that is again where my journey was like slightly on a back foot again, my interests were. And then later on, I acknowledge and once again thank Dr. Khambate, Madam, principal of Cummins College. It was man's guidance which brought me down to cellular imaging and chromosome analysis. That is the topic which was finally, it was solvable. I could identify the research quotient, I was sure that 4 years, these problems are going to be enough to ensure my research contribution in terms of publications and in terms of IPR. So we need to please remember, because changing topics so many times is okay. I did spend almost a year. I started in 2007 and I registered for PhD with this topic in 2008. So almost 1 year was spent, and the journey, as I did share with you, included, it started with VLSI, not only changing topics in a given domain, but it included changing domains as well. So starting with VLSI, including floor planning, and then moving down with image processing and coming down with medical imaging. In medical imaging, going to cancer, as a problem definition, including the other parts like digital X-ray, and then finally landing on chromosome analysis. So we need to always remember that we have to have a directional market research. The research should be directional, in one direction. Current state of market that needs to be always considered, and that needs to be given importance about it. The most important importance in deciding the problem. So yes, your interest, your comfort in the domain definitely matters. But I would appeal to everyone that what matters above is ensuring that seeing a bigger picture down the line, 3 years or 4 years, and being confident and committed that yes, this problem gives me scope to contribute. So, and especially because our STTP is on medical imaging, I would appeal everyone to, you know, understand the processes and challenges, confirm the availability of the standard and the practical database, which is again one very important and crucial challenge when it comes to biomedical domain. Have continuous discussions with doctors and the lab technicians, and network with like-minded technocrats and researchers. That's how networking with Dr. Asha Multani helped me to, you know, putting a problem statement on cancer off the list. So you need to network, and not everybody we approach are interested in talking to us, and that is okay. We will definitely land up with people who are interested to connect with us. So please see for online solutions and available resources, and see where the market is. Are there software which are aiming to do it? If it is so, what are the challenges? And the challenges and the issues that are reported, are they solvable by you? And while doing all this, you need to take care of at recent developments and upcoming related events. That's when this news was up in 2008, that we will have the biggest labs that are being set up in Pune. And that is how it helped me to connect to Prakash Gambhir sir and Moghe madam. So you need to know that it involves all the dimensions before you can finally conclude a solvable problem. Please ensure that the problem is solvable. Please ensure that you have the resources available. Please ensure that it has a research component in it. So that's how I finalized the topic on automated pattern recognition for chromosome analysis. So if I can bring you down to the topic now, there are some do's and don'ts even when you finalize the topic. So like here, I knew that the work that I do is on chromosome analysis. I knew that I will start with this particular image, which is called as metaphase. And I knew that my end product is something of this kind, where given this as an image, my job will be to pair the classifier, to pair the chromosomes. We human beings, we do have 22. Pairs of similar chromosomes received from each parent. And then we do have one pair which decides the gender, and that's how it comes down to 23 pairs or 46 chromosomes. So given a metaphase image, I know that my, this is the input. I know that my scope of project will include, will start from this point, and it will end up with this pairing up of 23 pairs and classifying them and having a major class like A, B, C, D, E, FG, which is called as Denver's group, and then having a classification problem as these 23 pairs. And the biggest challenge in this particular case is, you know, extracting the features when chromosomes are non-rigid. They can take any shape, they're not rigid bodies. They can take any shape, they're non-rigid bodies. They can be highly curved, they can be overlapped. Extracting the features will be a problem. If the chromosomes are touching and overlapping, it's a problem. If the chromosomes are, they appear in clusters, problem. If the chromosomes, if I cannot extract the band features because the chromosome is not straight, it is a problem. So I was confident that given so many challenges, at least some of them are definitely solvable. At least some of them will give me a very good publication, because I always need to look at bigger picture. We are doing it. There is a percentile who are genuine researchers, and they're doing it like for contribution. While we also have this as an aim, we are also doing it for that degree. And we need to keep it in mind that we need to finally contribute everything that is needed for that degree. So that's where I landed up on the problem. And now framing the problem was automated pattern recognition for chromosome analysis. So here I would like to bring to your notice the diplomacy that I have struck finalizing the topic, and I ensure that I will always have good scope of changing my experimentation and changing my approach or the choice of the algorithms, and changing the in terms of imaging and bringing pattern recognition. So I did only decide one point that I'm going to analyze chromosomes. I have used all broad terms in my title. I did not say that I will be using neural networks. I did not say that I will karyotype the chromosome, finding that array is nothing but karyotyping. So I did not say, I only said that I will analyze the chromosomes and I will do it using pattern recognition. So I did keep a good tolerance band, a good flexibility, because when we start our research, we really don't have an idea of what is going to give me very good substantial results. And that's the point. I need to keep all options open. So whichever options I choose, I still do justice to the title that has been finalized and the objectives and the scope. So this is what is being done. The blood sample is taken, it's cultured, it's incubated, and then I arrive at the stage of cell division, wherein I take these chromosome count into picture. And there are stages of cell division, which include anaphase, prophase, mitosis, and metaphase. And it is metaphase when my research begins. So that's how I decided the scope. And I still called it automated, because my automation starts from the step of, chromosome analysis. That's where my process starts. So we also need to remember that why do we say we need to justify that, why do we need automation in it? So if you see the title, my title was Automated Pattern Recognition for Chromosome Analysis. So I need to now justify that, why is it a pattern recognition problem and why do I need automation in it? And that's when that's when I need to using a very pinpoint approach, I need to understand the limitations of manual karyotyping. And the listed limitations is automation a solution for it. So we need to understand that first I need a solvable problem. If the problem is it solvable with the resources that I have? Or the resources which are required, are they all easily available? Then I need to see that 4 years down the line, will it still be a substantial problem? Will it still be a good research topic, or it will end up being outdated? I need to see a picture 4 years down the line. And then the challenges which are faced is the solution that I am giving of automation, does it address the issue? So the limitations of manual karyotyping are laborious, lengthy, tedious, and we need a cytogenesist. It is time consuming. There are human errors. There is also a storage problem, and it is expensive in terms of hours and resources that are spent. So if these are all the limitations that I have in that particular problem, yes, automation is a solution for it. And that's where I realized that this can be a very good topic, which was given to me by Dr. Khambate madam. So now if this is the problem, I also need to remember that, is the problem very old? Is there already a lot of research contribution on it? Or is it a new problem? And are there solutions in real world available already for the given problem statement? And that's where the groundwork of origin of whatever you're doing. When did this automation start? So it started with Ledley proposing that we can have a computer system for karyotyping, and then later on followed by a CAS person, wherein it did say that I can use features. So these were the milestones in automated karyotyping. And then later on in 1980s, there were some softwares which were developed, and these softwares still had major limitations. And the limitations were, if at all the chromosomes comes in cluster, how do I segment it? If the chromosome is isolated and overlapping, I as a human being understand it, but how will machines understand it? How will I extract the features of highly curved chromosomes? How am I going to separate the touching chromosomes? If at all the chromosomes are overlapping, how am I going to disentangle them? And how will I still develop an efficient classifier for doing it? And that's where the next part of research starts. And the next part of research says that, what does the survey, what are the findings? Just give me a minute, I'm sorry. So the most important next part of your research, when it is biomedical domain, you need to extend your survey not only to the papers, but also the findings from the doctors and in the practically deployable systems. So you need to incorporate those that part of, which becomes very crucial, especially when it is in the biomedical domain. So this finally helps me to define a problem. And when defining the problem, all I am saying is, this research will aim to develop efficient techniques for automated karyotyping by processing a metaphase image. So I would like to draw your attention to the way I'm defining my problem, I am declaring the scope that I will start from metaphase. No energy, no path, no objective, no scope of my research will ever include improvement or contributions in drawing the blood samples or using the needle, or how do I go for incubation or the devices for incubation or identifying metaphase? No. My problem statement says that I will process a metaphase image. So I have made it explicitly clear that the scope of my research will start from metaphase image, and I will develop efficient techniques. Now, again, I would like to draw your attention that I am saying efficient, but I am not defining or declaring the parameters which will prove the efficiency. I'm not doing it right now. So let me experiment. Even if I'm able to solve more challenges, my technique is efficient. Even if I'm able to do it in less amount of time, it is efficient. Even if I'm able to do it with less computational complexity, my algorithm is still efficient. So I would like to draw your attention to the generalization that I have used when defining the problem by using the word efficient techniques and still keeping the scope very restricted by saying that I will process a metaphase image. So the point that I would like all of you, all the PhD aspirants, to please note that we are striking the balance of keeping the flexibility, giving the tolerance and the needed change and shift in experimentation, but I am still also simultaneously keeping the input, like the scope of my project, very clear. So it is very imperative in your research that you strike the flexibility and still keep the scope limited, so that you know that what you are doing, and let the approach be very flexible. So all I commit is I will reach JSPMS College for this expert lecture. Now I will do it in a very smart way. Okay, and now the options that I have is I can drive my own car and I come to it, and I can claim advantages if this is the method. I can still tell that I have efficiently used my time. I did not rely on the public transport, and that's the reason I have used my time. When coming all the way here, because it's going to take 1 hour to reach JSPMS College from PICT. So in these 1 hour, I scheduled 2 meetings on Microsoft Teams, and I took it while I was driving. And that's the reason the method of me driving and coming to JSPMS is efficient. So doing this, I have justified why am I efficient. And I have also done justice to the scope, because the scope was I will reach JSPMS before 12:30 today. So I did justice to the scope. Now, when I have done this algorithm, this experiment, I still do. I carry out the second algorithm where I use the transport, the public transport available in terms of those buses which have Wi-Fi connectivity. And now I make a claim that instead of driving, instead of me being conscious, instead of me taking care of the road and my vehicle, and instead of spending my own petrol, I have done it in less. The money that I have spent is less. The contribution that I did in terms of concentration on the road and being a safe driver is less. And I have still taken those 2 meetings relaxing in the bus. So because I took less money, I needed less money, and because I, in terms of my concentration, I have saved upon, the energy that was spent. So because of these 2 methods, my research again is efficient. So the thing that I'm trying to tell you here is every experimentation that I do should ultimately do justice to the title. You should always remember the objectives, the scope, the experimentation that you do, fitting in and doing justice to both the things. So everything that I do, I should be able to prove that it is still efficient and it is still being done by metaphase image. So that is the final ultimate thing that we need to remember. And because the domain is biomedical, continuous input and acknowledgement and validation from the medical practitioners is also imperative. So that's how we decide the objectives. We can always keep objectives very short. We can keep it generic. The objectives, there is a standard template which you can always do, is it will include, the objectives will first include revalidation of the methods, of the most popular methods which are already existing in the literature. You validate it at the first place, then you modify them, and after doing this you are apt to go to some novel algorithms and finally end up designing an efficient system which maps your title. So free include these parameters where you just give me a minute. I will just a minute. I'm sorry.
Hello, madam.
Hello, sir. Just half a minute. I'm sorry, sir. Just half a minute. Okay. Apologies to keep you waiting. Hello. So let's get started. So coming down to these objectives, my complete urge and appeal to all of you is always strike the balance. Regardless of the problem statement, always we can try and keep it generic. And the objectives will always include these parts wherein you are trying to revalidate the methods. You are trying to ensure that there are some contributions that are done. You are trying to a bit. You are trying to still include practical deployment of the system on practical database when it is especially a biomedical problem. So when it comes to biomedical problem, the most important part is validation of the system from the medical practitioners, which should also be your objective. And whatever objectives I am doing, I am addressing, ultimately, it should do justice to the title that I have chosen. So throughout your research, I need to always have them that awareness that, okay, this is my title. This is the objective. I will do this experimentation. I will achieve this result. And I will solve this problem reported in the literature. And I will claim it as my contribution. So the cycle, if I may please repeat, is your title frame, your objectives. This experimentation, by doing this experimentation, which problem which was reported are you solving? And by solving that problem, you are contributing. So it is not necessary that each and every experimentation will lead to major contribution. But it should at least lead to some finding. It will at least lead to some validation, as we will see in our slides further. So that is how we need to proceed. So all these blocks need to be always activated in our brain. Title, objective, which experiment, which challenge I have solved, and how can I report it as a contribution. So that's how, once this part is done, I am able to frame the block diagram of my research, where the input is a metaphase image. I will segment it. After segmentation, I will be able to see all the chromosomes. Having the chromosomes, individual chromosomes, I will extract the features, which will be band patterns. Having these band patterns, I will ultimately classify the chromosome, and I will be able to tell the classes as we just did see. So this basically is the karyotyped image, and the first image is metaphase, and that is what was very well declared in the problem statement, and these are more or less the blocks which will be used. So this is something which was done like many years back, almost it has been 13 years back. And now, perhaps in biomedical research, I may not always have crisp blocks of segmentation, feature extraction, and classifiers. With deep learning and generative adversarial networks, I can do all of them in a joint approach, the crisp boundaries. So we need to remember this in the current scenarios. And then, as I did say, most important part when it goes to biomedical research, I mean, I urge everyone to ensure the availability of the database before finalizing the topic. Why is it this important? Because I just cannot tell my reviewers that I have been spending days and nights looking for databases. So the database is again a resource, because that doesn't count. The results count. So ensure that you have a publicly available database. Ensure that you have database from private genetic lab. Ensure that you have the flexibility and facility of simulating the database as and when you require them. Because why do I need all three of them? When I am trying to publish a paper, I need some threshold to compare. It cannot be merely indicative. I need to have upgradations and developments, and I need to have something with which I can compare. So if there are publicly available database, if there are researchers who have already worked on MPhish database and BioIM lab, I can compare that, okay, these researchers have worked on this publicly available database and got 92%, and on the same available database, I got 94% because of this algorithm, and design and development of this algorithm is the contribution. So you always, as I'm repeatedly telling, that you need to have that loop closed, that why this algorithm and what did you address, and how did this choice of the algorithm help you to address it. And that's where you will need publicly available database, and you also need private genetic lab database. Why? Because when you're working in biomedical researcher, you need validation from biomedical practitioners. If you want validation, I wanted validation from Moge madam. I wanted validation from Prakash Gambhir sir, because that is something which is satisfying and an added advantage of the system that you're designing. So when will Prakash Gambhir sir acknowledge or accept my work? When it works in their scenario. And in biomedical research, it is very necessary, it's of utmost importance that you it is of utmost importance that you connect to the, you have this association and you connect to them and you have their database and you can show that your system works on their database. And in the research contributions, you can write that the system was practically deployed. And that's the reason you should always remember to have database from practical, from your private genetic labs. And then you can claim benefit of it even in your publications. And then on the top of it, you can say that up to 7 there are up to 7 chromosome clusters is something which is available practically, okay? And they were not available in publicly available database. And in private database, it was very small set. So I have simulated it and created my own database. So always dimensions are important in biomedical imaging. Publicly then you have database from private genetic labs. The database from private genetic labs will help you for practical deployment. And then simulated database, which will show your added advantage. Will show the added advantage and of what you have taken practically. And that will help you to come out with other research contributions and go for a deployment of systems in the practical domain. So that is very important in biomedical research point of view. And these are the screenshots of research, these are the screenshot of images obtained from genetic lab where they literally have to handwrite it and write it. Then some of the overlapped chromosomes and then some of them from publicly available database. So we can see the difference and we can include it. And that's where we move down to the first block, which is nothing but segmentation and segmentation of chromosomes and clusters of chromosomes. And this is where I would like the importance of using traditional approaches and showing that they are going to fail. As I did repeatedly say that in my PhD or during my research, I just cannot see that why did I use this experiment? Like we do it in our mini project, that why did I select this diode for the power supply or in the rectifier? Because I did these calculations, which say that which says that the power supply should be which does say that the PIV rating has to be this much, and of these were the diodes which were available, and of these I have selected this. So always if you remember, okay, always if you remember all the parts, we need to justify the choice, and to justify the choice you need to validate it. So when you validate it first, you will be able to justify the choice. So it should not be mere experimentation. We should be able to put up that why did I choose this algorithm? How did choosing this algorithm either helped me or did not help me achieve the results? And most importantly, my focus is the challenges in the literature. So what I want each and every chromosome to be identified so that I can proceed towards feature extraction. And this is exactly what will be done in segmentation. So whenever I start my research, I really cannot high-end methods. Let me first use the traditional approaches, which are popularly reported, and let me show what are the limitations of this traditional segmentation approach and why do I need a new approach? So traditional approaches of global thresholding does not yield me the required outputs, wherein I have to identify the small pieces. And whenever I have 13 chromosomes, the problems of region merging achieve. And when I want watershed segmentation, it is not giving me the results because it ends up demanding further morphological process. So either show that the traditional methods failed, there are limitations of the traditional methods, and then let me go to rough set theory, wherein I'm having the liberty of upper approximation and the lower approximation, which is important in chromosome because the size of the chromosome is not fixed. There is upper range, there is a lower range to it, and I need a segmentation algorithm which will incorporate the upper and the lower approximations and the granule slide. That's where rough set theory comes in picture, and that is where I have used rough set, which justifies my choice, the upper and lower or the roughness in the chromosomes. This is exploited using rough set theory, which ended up giving me relatively relatively good results, okay, wherein the earlier problems of region merging are solved. But now this rough set theory gives me a new problem wherein the density of the chromosome matters. So the point that I'm trying to make here is, okay, I started with traditional methods. The traditional methods did not work. I did see what is the nature of my problem. Because there is upper and lower approximation, I did choose something, in terms of segmentation, which will help me to exploit that, which definitely has solved those problems, but has led to a new problem. So how do I write research contribution is design and development of a new rough set based approach, which addressed the problems of region merging reported in the literature. However, the granular size had to be manually taken, which is nothing but the window size. So based on the density of the chromosomes, I had to decide the segmentation method, but my problem is automated and now I cannot bring manual interference. And that is the reason I still needed further research to go for a new approach of random walker algorithm, where the results are improved and regardless of the density of chromosome distribution, I can get each and individual chromosome nicely separated, and while it has solved the problem, problem reported by rough set theory, but it has again given me new problem. The results are improved, but there is another limitation wherein the random walker algorithm, whenever the chromosome is touching and overlapping, identifies them as a different chromosome, which is again a problem in my research. And that is where I still need further improvement, wherein I can segment this touching and overlapping chromosome by altogether different approach. So what I'm trying to do, all respected and learned audience, is that I, given a problem at hand, I go by what is reported. I did show that there is a problem which cannot be solved by traditional approaches, and I did show that these are the characteristics of this problem. Now, other segmentation algorithms reported in the literature apparently look suitable here. While they have solved the problems reported in the literature, but they have given a room to new problems which demand still further research. So my approach is always what is reported, what challenges I am going to solve. I am never ever going to forget the word of research component, and I am never ever going to forget the word of contributions. Research component will ensure that I am addressing a challenge reported in the literature, and me addressing that challenge ensures the contribution. So this cycle I am going to completely keep it triggered, okay, throughout my research. So that is what will ensure good quality publication. That is what will ensure that you are doing a good research work. That is how your approach will be. And that is what I appeal to all the respected audience. So I started with traditional segmentation methods. They did not work. I chose random Walker algorithm because of flexibility in approximation, which matches very well with the flexibility in my size. This helped me to solve the problem reported in the literature, but it gave me a very different, it gave rise to another problem, which now altogether I have to solve using a new method. I need to modify the reported methods, and that is where your automatic shape models came in picture, because the problem was with touching and overlapping. And what are these automatic shape models doing? These automatic shape models are going to identify this touching and overlapping with the reported shape models. What is happening, as you can see, is I end up getting the entire cluster of the images. That is what happens, and that is what I end up getting at the end. And this is actually my contribution and my part. So what is important in the research, if I can appeal to all the learned audiences here, is you need to, throughout the research, showcase that whatever experimentation you are doing, may it be validation or may it be altogether a new algorithm which has been devised, in both the cases, you should be able to take credit of it. So I have explored the usefulness of RSD, which has never been done in literature. So the flexibility in the size of images, the variation in the size of images matches well with the variations in the upper and the lower approximation, which was exploited, which is a contribution. The reported snakes algorithm is not going to work for touching. The reported automatic shape models are modified by giving one more seed point, and this modification is my contribution. May it be minor contributions, it is okay. Not every experiment I do will yield a major contribution, but every experimentation I do will help me to march ahead at least by a micro step or a couple of steps by taking the steps ahead. So that is where I now come to the most severe problem. In your complete research, as you proceed ahead, you need a clear understanding and clear idea of where am I going to fit my major contribution? Where am I going to fit my minor contribution? And where will I only validation? And have that balance again. So now coming to the most important part of research is how we touching and overlapping chromosomes, which is the problem in existing software, in existing Dinanath-Moore-based genetic lab, in existing practical scenario. So that is where I need to now formulate it as a mathematical problem, a query detection problem, and I need to solve it. That first place, how will a human being say that it is touching? I can never ever forget that I am trying to replace a human being. So when I'm trying to replace a human being, I need to have something which will behave like a human being. Something which behaves like a human being needs to exhibit the intelligence and the experience of a human being. So how will I, as a human being, decide? Let me close my eyes and find, how will I decide if the objects are touching? I will trace them and find two nearest points, and that is exactly
exactly that I did in this particular research, wherein given a cluster, let me find two nearest points which lie on two different chromosomes. So what is it I do? I trace this chromosome, this particular chromosome, and I save all the points in one array. I trace another chromosome, save all the points. And in all this, now I find the nearest point. So if the nearest points are identified, I know if the chromosomes are touching or overlapping. So these are the TSMs, which is trainable shape models, that is required. And now, next point is, as a human being, if I have identified that this point is touching, how will I separate it? Is by knowing that I will have to cut the chromosome at this point. And that is where the next approach comes, that these are the non-overlapping segments of the chromosomes. These are the overlapping segments of a chromosome. Now, let us forget all high-end research. Let us look at it that how does a researcher or how does a human being look at this problem? And naturally, looking at this cluster, I know that, okay, these overlapping part that I see here, it all looks, it belongs to this particular purple color a segment, and this is the red color segment. The band patterns that we have, the segment, these band patterns, the orientation of these band patterns will help me identify. So major part of research, we also need to remember that ultimately a human being is getting, it is getting replaced. So how will human being think? And let me use that simple approach in my research. And does that yield something which is very fruitful? So this is exactly, I'm bringing you to the major contribution. So always let us get driven by papers, okay? But let us also remember when it is biomedical that we are replacing a cytogeneticist. And how is cytogeneticist going to look? And can I have similar biomarkers in my database? And does that simple approach help me to yield something which is out of the way and novel? So towards the end, when I'm writing, I need to remember that I need to have some minor contributions, some major contributions, and major contributions will only be when I have novel approaches and when I have most crucial problems reported in the literature being addressed. So as a researcher, a part of me should always think and have this neuron activated wherein I try to click this link. So a normal human being, I give this cluster to a kid. How a kid is going to separate it? It will identify the break that the purple lines are in orientation. It will end up finding, break it in this way, so that these are the two segments and this blue or the purple one is one segment. And that is exactly which brings me to the next contribution of my research, wherein the overlapping things of the chromosome were taken into account. And how will I identify the cut point? Excuse me. How will I identify the cut point? And how will I separate, break, cut the chromosomes? So a mere look at this tells me that if I see the quadrilateral formed, if I am able to find the area of all the quadrilaterals that will be formed by the points on the boundary, the biggest the biggest quadrilateral will be, the vertices of this quadrilateral will be the cut points of the chromosome. So this is what was a very keen observation, and based on this I could publish a paper. But now I bring you to another most important point, that this did help this approach, which I identified only based on a very keen observation, this did help me get some good publications. Definitely, it did work on all the chromosome clusters. It was in biomedical EMBS, POCH, PubMed, IEEE, EMBS are all reputed. I could get very good publications there. But again, when it came to journal publication, I got a review saying that although the method is working, although you have shown it on practical database up till 7 overlaps, we cannot accept the method until and unless it is mathematically modeled. So I wanted to share this experience because this took almost 6 to 8 months for me. I am again, excuse me, just for half a ji, pranam dada ji. So while this was a very good method, while it was successful, it is after 6 to 8 months I realized that I will have to model it mathematically for a very good publication. When I submitted this to Springer journal, it was rejected after 8 months, and the rejections, there was only one comment by the reviewer that it needs to be mathematically proven. So my appeal to all the audience here is, when you have identified a solution and when it is working, immediately you need to remember that it needs to be mathematically modeled. The point that you are saying, you should be able to frame it as a mathematical problem, and the solution that you have shown needs to be proven mathematically. Only then your approach can be done. Entire heuristic approaches will not be easily published. You are lucky if they are, but I was not, and I wanted to share it because this was towards the end. That it demands extra work for very good reputed publication, and that's where I could then think of Delaunay triangulation. I had to map it to Delaunay triangulation approach, which is a computational geometrical approach, which brings me to mathematically these quadrilaterals with maximum area being formulated and proven, and later on they being used to find the number of overlaps, to find the cut points, to identify even if the method is if the chromosome is touching or overlapping. And this is finally finally held a very good publication in Springer Journal of Medical and Biological Engineering and Computing. So it is JMBEC journal. Now, another problem with biomedical I would like to audience to note is the choice of the journal. We are always, many a times, the researchers are taken in sway because we cannot go to pure medical sciences. The journal is pure medical sciences, nor can we go to pure engineering because it's application based. So I would like to appeal to to all the participants here is, there is one trick that you see, you have papers, you should always see at the journals where these papers were published, and you can see the maximum journal, the journal with maximum research. And that should be your first target. Another experience that I had, and the reason it took 8 months more, was I first submitted it to Springer Journal on Image Processing, DIP Journal, and it was not selected because after a couple of months, I got the review that you submitted to this particular journal. So I want to know that later on, I learned that there are journal finders. You have journal finders in Springer, for elsewhere, for IEEE, and all you do is you submit your abstract, and you'll get the list of the journals which suit the abstract, and you can save time which I based for finding the good journal. So that was one point. And the point of mathematical modeling was one point as the hurdle that I got. And we need to strike that diplomacy even in writing the papers. Like if you can see, I wanted to share this as well. If you can take a keen look, instead of publishing the results on the entire database, I did split it in set one, set two, set three, and set four. Because if you see set four, my results were less. Now, if I try to take average, I am going to compromise on my experimental results. So what did I choose? I choose to put up the and showcase that I have got 100% accuracy on single overlapping two chromosome, which is morely worked upon and taken care of by most of the researchers. But there I have got 100%, which everybody is doing. I got 100%. But set 2, 3, and 4, where people are not taking look at, I have addressed those problems, although I got 77%. So instead of writing in the manuscript that my accuracy is relatively good, I am instead choosing to write that my accuracy is best for something which everyone is doing, and I am going beyond it. I am identifying an unreported problem of more than two chromosome overlaps, and there I am getting excellent results, and I'm still going beyond that. I go to four chromosome overlaps which nobody has done, and there also I am getting 77. So my appeal once again at this point is we need to take care of the way we are publishing our results. We need to be very honest, because if we manipulate, we will be caught. It is Milan Sonka, people like Milan Sunka, who literally review these papers, and at a go they know if we are trying to manipulate. So my appeal is, instead of manipulating, instead of writing that up to four chromosome, beyond four overlaps I got 80, I have written what I have got and still taken credit of it by projecting it in a way that I have addressed a problem which no one did, and 77 is still a very good amount. So always when writing these publications, we need to take a very good care of the way we present it, and this is one hint that I would like to share with all of you, which helped me in a great way. So the reviewer comments where unaddressed problems are identified, and not only identified but solved, because that is what I wanted reviewers to look at. That is the way I wrote the manuscript. So this also matters a lot in your publication. And you can like the way I wrote that. Coming to the last point, I'm from the practical perspective, nobody has worked on identifying the chromosomes which are overlapping and which are in cluster and which have around seven overlaps. So nobody has done any work on identifying it. Now all of them need different treatment. If the chromosome is in cluster, I need to separate it first. If it is touching, I need to separate it first. If it is isolated, I can directly go for extraction. If it is highly curved, I will have to straighten it. Now, researchers are working on all of it. But again, as I did tell that, always keep a human being in you very alive, that how are you going to solve this problem? And that is where I took credit of one more important point, that Delaunay triangulation, which was already used to solve the major problem, can also be a solution to this unidentified problem, wherein based on the adjacency of the triangles, I decide is the chromosome overlapping or not. So I see this, I find the vertices and all of them have only one neighbor. So definitely it is isolated. You look at it, there are so many neighbors, that means it is overlapping. The vertices are common, means it is again touching and overlapping. So the computation of Delaunay triangulation, which served as a problem, I exploited Delaunay triangulation. I used degree and index of the triangles to solve one more very important problem of identifying if the chromosome is overlapping or touching or isolated, which is the major rung. So these are the contributions of the research. And as I did say, that not every section will give you major contributions. My major contributions were in that section, and rest of the contributions in straightening a highly curved chromosomes are all minor chromosomes. So something, if it is curved, we will straighten it. Again, the approach will be same. We will find the bending center and we will straighten it. And that is exactly what I did. So in biomedical, let's always remember, how does a doctor do it? How does a doctor do it? What are the biomarkers? And then let us technically find the biomarkers. So this approach always helps. Always this approach helps. Wherein, how is a cytogenesis doing it? And can I have an algorithm of doing it in that way? And even if the contribution is not substantial, you can still, as I'm showing you, you can still work on it, and you can still show that it is a minor contribution in terms of revalidation. So that brings me like to the end of this sessions, wherein as you see on the screen, that only doing a careful study and a keen observation and marking a centromere position is also a contribution. So I have done that, and I only did not study, but outcome of this study or the end effect of this study, the observation has helped me in the decision making, and that is my contribution. So always you can pose it in that way, and you can always take credit of all the things that you are doing, and the journey can always be like validation and then modification and then something which is novel, which was not reporting. So whenever you are trying to use the reported approaches of reported approaches, you should always be able to show that how did I make best use of what I had. I developed a Delaunay triangulation for overlapping and separating, but that helped me to solve one more problem. I already used a rough set theory, but if I can use it with genetic algorithm, it will help one. It will give me one more solution. And then you can go to something which is called catastrophic forgetting, as you see later. I'm slightly moving ahead because it was me that it is one, but I want you to look at the important slides. That most important part, again, as we come to the end, is having this incremental learning. So this incremental learning is one researchers can exploit in their own research. And that was one more important contribution, which gave me a very good publication. So I think that is all that I had to share. So in this particular results and writing these things and seeing how a human being will do it, and then are trying to map it with technical things and showcasing the contribution. So writing it down in a way which will be appealing, and every contribution that you have done, it needs to confirm that you have addressed some of the other challenge which was reported in the literature. So the overall developments that we have, this is the diagram which you can always design even for your own research, wherein at a go you are trying to tell everything that you have done in this research. So looking at this diagram, I know that I'm working on metaphase, I'm pre-processing an image, I'm trying to identify isolated, curved, and touching chromosome. I'm making it a point that if it is isolated, I can directly go for feature extraction. But if at all it is curved, or if it is touching, or if it is overlapping, in that particular case, I have to go do a lot of jugglery, and this was completely ignored in the research. So that's where I take credit by sharing and showcasing entire research at the Go, and this was very well appreciated by the reviewers. So that this is something that I wanted to share with all of you. Some good things that were appreciated and some things where I went wrong, and perhaps early realization would have helped me, as I told, during mathematical modeling or thinking like a human being. This also I developed towards the end. But when it is biomedical, we always need to keep one question fueled up, that how is a doctor doing? And now how can I use an algorithm to identify the same and lead to exactly, same output? And how have I taken care of reported disadvantages and limitations? So it is like identifying, separating, and curved chromosomes. Touching was a problem. Delaunay triangulation helped me. Identifying a centromere was a problem. Mere observation helped me. And then you also wanted multiple chromosome overlaps was a problem. That also was taken care of. So touching, there was a framework which was done. And then you have these intelligent classifiers which were developed. That is also being taken care of. So this you need to always remember when writing contribution, as I'm repeatedly telling, that you have done justice to the question, to the problem statement. You have done justice to the reported challenges, and your contributions have addressed the issues in the literature survey. So always you can try and write it in that particular way. And these are some of the next problem statements that can be taken up by all of you interested ones now, where it is you can extend this research further for disease-specific, genetic disease-specific research or method, and use it. So these were some of the accomplishments wherein INA, fellowships from INAE, and these fellowships can be taken. So I did get that fellowship wherein you can identify a fellow of INAE, and then INAE pays you 40,000 rupees. It was back then in 2013 for staying at IIT and learning from them. And though that fellowship is for 2 months, that was all different direction to my research. And that fellowship helped me to connect with Dr. Mukhopadhyay, which helped me in a long way. So there are so many grants and policies and funds for the researchers who are pursuing PhD, and you should always take benefit of it. So my entire London conference publication was sponsored by DST. I also got a grant from DST. So you can always keep on doing all these things which will help you in your research. And these are some of the publications that I shared. And with this, I will like to conclude my talk, where I'll acknowledge and deeply I'm gratified to my own respected guide, to Jayant Mukhopadhyay sir, to Birthright Clinic and Moghi ma'am, and of course to Khambate ma'am for giving me this topic. So with this, I would like to pass on to all of you, and would be happy to discuss anything you would like to with me.
Hello.
Thank you so much. Yeah.
Thank you, madam. Myself, Dr. S. T. Wallace.
Yes, sir. Oh, sir. How are you doing, sir?
Nice, man. Okay.
Oh, so glad to hear from you, sir. My regards.
Okay. Nice session. Some questions, madam. Question,
yes,
number one is, what is different between chromosomes analysis and CNN?
And?
CNN, actually convolutional neural network.
Yeah, sir, chromosome analysis is the a topic that I used, and CNN is the algorithm that can help me in classification of the chromosomes. So chromosomes is like human chromosomes, which we need. And CNN is the algorithm. I can have CNN based methods. I can have ensemble based methods. I can go for deep learning. I can use adversarial networks, and I can have all these CNN based approaches to solve or to address the issue of chromosome classification. So that is the difference.
Okay. And what is the difference between genetic algorithm also?
Genetic algorithm, I go by population size and I go by best fit. So what is done in genetic algorithm is I design this chromosome classification as a pairing approach, wherein I find the best pair, because if you remember, I did say that there are 22 pairs wherein both the chromosomes are same. So if I have to classify them, I can also define it as a pairing problem. And I can find the best pairs. And this best pairs can be done using genetic algorithm. So in genetic algorithm, I take this as a 46 class problem. And I take the population size of 46. And using genetic algorithm, these permutations and combinations that I do, I will find the best pair of chromosome. And instead of classifying it, I will first pair it, and then I will pair that class. Sometimes if there are not, like in Up syndrome and Down syndrome, kids who are differently abled, in them, the size of the chromosome count, the count of the chromosome is either less or more. So if I frame it as a pairing problem, I can immediately know that are there 22 pairs. And then and there I can know that is it a Up syndrome or a Down syndrome problem. Yeah, okay. That is what is being done.
Okay, thank you very much, madam.
Thank you, sir.
Good afternoon, one and all. I, Dr. S.C. Vargas, on behalf of Rajarshi Shahu College of Engineering, Kathmandu, Pune, extends a very hearty vote of thanks to dynamic personality, Dr. Mrs. Mosni Munot, for sharing her valuable thoughts. Madam, thank you very much for exploring automated pattern recognition for chromosomes analysis, automated karyotyping systems, efficient techniques for automated karyotyping, databases used and generated in biomedical research, segmenting tile touchings and overlapping chromosome clusters. This session has given informative in this regard. Thank you very much, madam.
Thank you so much, sir. It is always a pleasure to share something little that I have learned, and I'll be indeed glad if whatever is being shared helps you and saves your time and helps our respected audience to perform better. So thank you so much for the opportunity. I remain grateful to all of you. Thank you, sir. With your permission, may I leave the meeting, sir?
Yes, madam.
Thank you, sir. Okay. Thank you so much. Best regards, sir. Thank you.
Over to Pranav, sir. The next session will be on 2 p.m. Okay. Rajesh. All participate, your next session will be start at 2 p.m. Okay. Hello, madam. Hello, Rajesh.
Hello. Yes, sir. Hello.
Hello, Rajesh. Hello, Bulbul sir.
Yes, sir.